In this video, we're going to wire up a house. Well, it's not really a house, it's just a wooden board, and we're simulating a house here. We're going to have three outlets, a power meter, and a circuit breaker box. The purpose of this video is to show, basically, in a single-phase house, how the wiring is done. Keep in mind that watching this video doesn't make you an expert or an electrician. I'm not following any electrical codes here. The purpose is just to show how the wiring is carried out from a circuit standpoint. If you want to wire up your own circuit breaker box or do your own wiring, of course, then you need to follow whatever electrical codes are applicable in your own jurisdiction. This is just for educational purposes here. So with that in mind, let's get started. The first thing we're going to do is provide power to our household. Now I've got two different sizes of wiring here. We've got thinner wiring, and then we've got thicker wiring over here. Usually in a house, the thicker wire brings in that power from the utility company because it would obviously have to carry more current. And then thinner wiring would distribute that electricity out to various circuits in a household from individual circuit breakers. Although the electricity coming to a household in the actual case would be controlled by the utility company, here we're just going to plug it into the wall. All the circuit breakers that I'm going to be wiring up here are of much lower amperage than the circuit breakers and the wiring here in the lab are capable of carrying. So there's no danger here of us accidentally tripping a circuit breaker back in the lab. We're going to wire it up to the wall, and I have a UK style plug here. Let's take it apart and see what's inside. We can see that we have a 13 amp fuse, three connections here. Ground would be up at the top, and then we have two lines for hot and neutral. Let's go ahead and hook our cable up to our plug here. It was relatively easy to get it wired up correctly because the plug is marked N for neutral, L for hot, L stands for line, and then there's a little symbol for the earth ground so I know which one the little green and yellow cable plugs into. The brown one goes to hot, the blue one goes to neutral, and that's the color code that we're using here in Singapore. That's aligned with the new UK standard and also with the colors that they're using in the EU. Before I deal with the other end of the cable, I'm going to go ahead and seal this plug up. We're going to eventually plug this into the wall, and this is going to provide the power from the utility company to our house here. The other end is going to go to our electricity meter. We have a little electricity meter here to simulate what the utility company would be doing. There would typically be a shutoff switch that the utility company would control. This particular meter here tells us exactly how to wire it up. We can see here that the line or the hot goes here to terminal one, the neutral from the utility company goes to terminal three, and then two is the line going out to the load, and four is the neutral going out to the load. So I'm going to go ahead and make those connections and we'll install our meter into our box. Our box here doesn't have any convenient place for me to attach the earth. So what I've done here is I've left the earth cable intact. This cable is going to come from the utility company, and then this little cable here is going to go from our electricity meter down here to our circuit breaker box. I'm going to go ahead and wire up our electrical meter here according to the wiring diagram. It's spring-loaded on the back and it attaches to this rail here. This is called a DIN. So we have our electricity meter now clamped down to our box. We have one cable that comes from the utility company and another cable carrying earth, ground, and neutral that we're going to run into our circuit breaker box right here. The first circuit breaker that I'm going to be installing is the main switch. Usually this is a two-pole circuit breaker. Therefore, if there's some fault, it would switch off both the hot and the neutral. These circuit breakers on the side will usually tell you which side needs to be hooked up to the line and which side needs to be hooked up to the load. In this case, they're not labeled, so in theory, you could run it in either direction. But I'm going to be running the line from the bottom, and then I'm going to run the load out from the top. I'm going to be putting the main circuit breaker on the left side of the circuit breaker box. You'll see why I'm doing that here in a moment, but it's also possible to have the main breaker on the right and then work your way left. The next thing that we're going to be wiring up is the ground fault device or the residual current device. This is to protect against shocks, and this one is rated at 10 milliamps, which is smaller than typical. By the way, my main circuit breaker here is only rated at 3 amps, so everything is going to be smaller than it would be in an actual house. So they usually put this safety device here adjacent to the main circuit breaker, and it's very important with this safety device that neutral and hot are respected. We can see here that neutral is indicated by the letter N. The reason I'm going from left to right here rather than right to left is because I've noticed down here on my safety device that the load side is a hot connection. I'm later going to be using these bus bars to connect this hot up to the hot connections of all my single pole circuit breakers here. So if I have a single pole circuit breaker next to my safety device, I'll be able to connect all the hots up with a single bus bar. And that's easier if we have all the hots going from left to right here. What I'm going to do now is to take both these circuit breakers out and make the connection from the main switch over here to the safety device. I've connected neutral to neutral and hot to hot. So it's the lower side here of the safety device that will be protected against ground faults. For the neutral connection coming out here at the bottom, I'm going to connect that to a neutral bar. And from here, we can distribute it to all the other circuits in the house. So before I put these breakers back in the box, I'm going to mount our neutral bar. This particular box came with a little plastic rail, and it can be mounted up here at the top of the box. The left side has a ground symbol, and the right side has a symbol N. So I'm going to respect those markings and put my neutral connection for all of the individual circuit breakers over on the right. This terminal block has two different sizes of screws. It has two large ones and several smaller ones. We're going to be using one of the large connections here, since this is the main neutral connection, and then we'll be using the smaller ones to distribute the neutral line to the individual circuits here in the house. So we have our neutral bar installed right now. I'm going to run this wire from the output here of our safety device up to our neutral bar, and from there we can hook it up to the rest of our circuits. We now have our neutral bar mounted and wired up to a safe neutral connection. I'm going to mount the earth connection over here on this side, and I'm going to go ahead and screw in our main earth connection, and from there we can distribute it to all the other circuits that we're going to build here. At this point, we're ready to go ahead and install our main circuit breakers. I'm going to be installing two of these. They're both 1 amp circuit breakers, so it's a lot smaller than what you would typically find in a house. But this is just a simulation here. When these circuit breakers are sitting here in the box, we're going to have the hot coming from our safety device, and then the switched hot will be coming here from the top of each individual circuit breaker. So from the top of this circuit breaker, for example, we can distribute the electricity to one of our outlets over here by taking the hot, the neutral, and the earth. Let's go ahead and do that for this particular circuit breaker. We're going to be using our bus bar. And because I'm only going to be wiring up two circuit breakers, I'm going to cut the bus bar right here so we have three prongs showing. I'm going to go ahead and cut it right now. But before I do that, let me show you what's behind the plastic. It's just a piece of copper. So the idea is to shield the hot connections down here by having all the circuit breakers here lined up at the bottom. I'll cut some insulation for it too. We've got the bus bar ready, but before we mount it, I'd like to think a little bit about the load side of our circuit. Let's take a break here from our main circuit breaker and build our outlets over here. These are British style outlets, so they have ground, neutral, and hot, but it's pretty much like that anywhere in the world. They're marked here on the back, L, N, and a ground symbol. So L here stands for line. These will be mounted face inwards in each of these three outlets. This first outlet over here, I'm going to wire to its own circuit breaker. And then these two here, I'm going to put them in parallel with the second circuit breaker. That way we can experiment later with different load conditions. I'll be using thinner cable here for our loads. That's exactly what you would find in a house as well. The load carrying capacity of the wires coming into the house would be higher than those that go out to the individual circuits. In order to simulate wiring in a house, I'm going to run the wiring here from the back of our wall. Then I'm going to strip the wires and make the connections on our outlet. I have hot, neutral, and ground wired up here to the outlet. We can now close up the box. So the other end of the wire would either run through the wall or through conduit. I have a piece of conduit here, so we'll simulate running the wire through the wall by running it through this conduit over to our main circuit breaker. The other side of this wire has three connections, hot, neutral, and ground. The hot will connect to the top of the circuit breaker, neutral will connect to this bus bar, and ground will connect over here. So now that we have this circuit breaker in place, other than the bus bar, I'm going to wire up these other two outlets. Now these outlets are going to be wired in parallel. That means that hot will go to hot, and then it will go over here to the breaker box, neutral will go to neutral, and then over to the breaker box, earth ground to the breaker box. So we finished two outlets. Let's go ahead and get outlet number three wired up and recall that it's in parallel with outlet number two. So we have both of these outlets here connected to this cabling. Again, I'm going to run it through the conduit to simulate its trip through the walls in a normal house, and then we'll attach it to a second circuit breaker here in the box. I'll again connect the hot side of this circuit to the top of the circuit breaker, neutral to our neutral bar, and ground to the ground bar. Now that we have all of our connections made, we can go ahead and add our hot bus bar down at the lower side. We do have some end caps here. These are for safety purposes. We'll add those to the sides of the hot bus bars. We'll now make the final bus bar connection. So we've now made all the connections, and before we turn it on and test it out, let's just review what we've done and make sure that all of our connections are what we intended. So we have over here a plug that will simulate electricity coming from the utility company. We have hot, neutral, and ground that flow up here to our electricity meter. They go through the meter and down here into our box. The hot goes into our main circuit breaker along with the neutral, and the ground goes up here to a grounding bar. Hot and neutral flow through the main switch and over here to our safety device. Neutral, after the safety device, flows up here to our neutral bar. Hot flows to these other switches, and then the switched side goes to our circuits. This circuit breaker flows to this outlet, and this circuit breaker controls power that flows to these two outlets, which are wired in parallel. In order to test that everything's working correctly, we'll be plugging light bulbs into each of these three outlets. Everything is switched on here, so when I plug it in and trigger the switch, all three of these light bulbs ought to light up. Let's switch it on. Excellent, it looks like the circuit's working just fine. These are all 100 watt bulbs, so it's pretty bright. I have an ammeter right here. We're going to clamp on and see how much current we're drawing. So this is the kind of ammeter that's quite common to be used with AC circuits. It's really convenient because it can just clip onto a hot wire and tell you how much current's passing through it. Let's clip onto our hot wire here and see how much current our entire circuit is drawing. So it looks like we're drawing 1.27 amperes. We'll just leave that clipped on as we do various things here with our circuit. These are 100 watt bulbs. As I turn them off, we can see the current dropping. Now we're only drawing 0.42 amperes. When I turn it off, it should drop to zero, and it does. What I'd like to do now is to simulate a fault condition. I have one power strip plugged into outlet number one. I have another power strip plugged into that power strip, and then a third power strip plugged into that. So this is something that you ordinarily don't want to do. We have various 100 watt light bulbs plugged into the power strips. We're going to see how many light bulbs we can turn on before the circuit breaker trips. We're monitoring the current here flowing into our system with the ammeter. Let's start turning on these light bulbs here and see what happens. We're drawing 400 milliamps, around 800 milliamps, 1.2 amperes. Keep in mind, this is a 1-amp breaker, so we're actually over the rated current right now. Let's see how many light bulbs we can turn on before it actually trips, though. 1.6 amperes, 2.0 amperes, and 2.4 amperes. Let's see how long it takes the breaker to trip. We're in the overload zone right now. Not too much time. Technically, we shouldn't have more than two light bulbs plugged into this circuit at any one time, because anything more than two draws more than 1 ampere of current. Let's try the same experiment on outlets number 2 and 3. These circuits should still be active because this breaker is tripped, but that breaker only controls outlet number 1. When I start turning on light bulbs, we need to keep in mind that these two outlets are in parallel with one another, just like all of the power strips are in parallel with one another as well. We have this power strip over here hooked up to outlet number 2. We're now drawing 0.76 amperes. So although I don't have anything else plugged into this outlet, when I start turning on light bulbs hooked up to outlet number 3, I'm actually overloading the entire circuit that's hooked up to this far right breaker over here. We should soon overload that breaker as well. We're drawing 2.4 amps. So it also didn't take too much time to trip when I started overloading it. What I've done here on the circuit is set up a 3-ampere main switch and then two 1-amp switches to control the individual circuits. So the way I have it wired right now, it's highly unlikely that I would ever cause the main circuit breaker to trip. However, if you have a house, for example, with many of these individual switches, it's often the case that you could theoretically cause the main circuit breaker to trip without tripping any of the individual circuits. That could happen if none of the individual circuit breakers are overloaded, but the total of the current passing through those circuit breakers still exceeds what the main circuit breaker would be able to handle, the wiring that's coming into the house would be able to handle, for example. Hopefully what you've learned from this video is how these main circuit breaker boxes are typically wired up. This is a single phase setup. This is unlike those setups in North America, for example, that use split phase. We'll look at those in another video, but for now, I wanted to go ahead and disconnect our ammeter from the box and seal everything up nice. These boxes come with covers, so we'll screw these down and make everything look nice here in just a moment. We have to knock out some of these plastic things. Before I wrap up the video, I just want to say another few words about safety. There are some things that I've done which you could say are a little bit sloppy because I know that we're dealing with very low currents here and everything is reasonably safe. But again, this is just a simulation. Watching this video doesn't make you an electrician and it doesn't make you qualified to work on circuit breaker boxes. We have a whole series of professionally filmed and edited videos in order to help students learn the fundamentals of electricity. If you like watching this particular video, then you might like to check out some of our others too.